Good afternoon. Today I will be a little more leisurely than the hectic pace at which I had to go a week ago. And I'm covering a territory for which I have, as you may or may not know, produced a book. But I'm trying this time to not restrict the material to that which is in the book, nor is it really, am I necessarily saying the same things about the material that might be in the book. Because I think that the book, after all, started being written about 2 years ago, and one does shift one's view of things. And also you get, quite frankly, you get bored with saying the same thing about something. And I should let you in on a sort of secret, which is that much material that one can discuss in architecture can have almost anything said about it. It depends what mood you're in, what angle you want to take on it, what relationship you want to give it to other things. And I'm going to talk about drawings, which may seem curious in an institution which has attached itself so much to the production of digital material. In the book, I very assiduously do not distinguish between work that is produced by a computer or a piece of charcoal or a pen or somebody's foot, if you're able to draw with your foot. I'm more interested in the ideas that attach to the making of drawings. And that, I suppose, will underlie what I say today. But on the other hand, I want to start with the business of whether one bothers to look at them. I think there is an interesting phenomenon now, which is that we are so confronted by phenomena. We're so, you know, that Barack Obama this morning must have appeared in front of all of us, both on television and in a number of newspapers, not only those that you buy, but those that you see glancingly over somebody else's shoulder, so that his face is seen from a number of different angles, and you sort of half, you get to a point where you sort of anticipate what he looks like and probably don't look. And I think drawings have something of the same condition, that we either have a thing for them or we just presume that they might or might not exist. I start off with two pictures taken hurriedly as I went round the Frieze Art Fair with my son. We were just snapping off things off the iPhone, so they're not brilliant photographs, they're just things seen in power. And of course there is inevitably the business of, in the Frieze Art Fair, which is so full of stuff, so full of people looking at stuff, that unless you invested an enormous amount of time, you do this sort of skittish, quick glance thing. And you are confronted, obviously, by objects such as that on the left, which are, I would cynically say, are almost organized or designed to stop you in your tracks. Despite that, the lady on with the glasses there is trying to pretend that she's not really looking at it. And in the right-hand photograph, which was a drawing my son wanted to look at, although I've forgotten what the name of the artist is, I can't tell if it's a man or a lady, it's a bad photograph, but the person with the glasses walking past has obviously not even noticed it. And yet, it's a rather good and interesting drawing. Not an architectural drawing, but it is a good and interesting drawing. But that person couldn't care. It was one of 5 million things that were in the Frieze Art Fair and obviously didn't interest him, her. And something different, and this is, as you can see, a bad photograph. It's full of reflections and so on. But it is different if we then either treat it as a piece of general landscape of an art fair, or if we come full frontally in front of it, and we then say, let us look at this and let us discuss the row of trees along the bottom vis-a-vis the kind of whirligig material in the middle. As I say, it's a quick photograph, so that the colour probably isn't actually on the drawing at all. It's something reflected in the glass. On the other hand, if we have Reiser and Omamoto being both inspired by a planned phenomenon and also, in a way, making semi-analytical drawings of the same phenomenon. Then we get into the hard stuff. We get into the question of the drawing being purposeful. And if we bother to look at the drawing at all, we're looking at it either in the top version as a preliminary systematic, or in the bottom version as that preliminary systematic is beginning to be interpreted towards becoming a piece of architecture. We become self-conscious for our own purposes. And I suppose if one is talking about drawings in a school of architecture, then in the main it is within that definition that we have to speak. That is to say, is it useful to me to bother about drawings? I can imagine a lot of you sitting, and even if you wouldn't like to admit saying it, you're probably thinking it to yourselves. I'm not really interested in unless it's useful. Unless you are an enthusiast, unless you're the kind of enthusiast who doesn't care whether certain things are useful or otherwise, you just love being around them. The same Reiser and Omamoto, Jesse Reiser, by the way, I once managed to get Daniel Libeskind before he became commercial, long ago. I managed to get him on one side in a bar in Tokyo and said, who do you think is your most impressive student? And he has had a lot of very famous, wonderful students. And he said, Jesse Reiser. If you push me to the corner, Jesse Reiser is the most talented of all the students I've ever had. It's interesting that some of the other of his students have become more successful, but Reiser is consistently talented and is somebody who uses the weaving of elements in the way that one might as one draws. I feel that whatever computer equipment or series of analyses he makes, that there is a spirit behind the way in which he weaves. And I think, actually, technically speaking, what we're looking at here is a model. But to me, the model is so much a piece of creative drawing that I can legitimately include it here. Here's another thing taken from the Frieze Art Fair. I can't remember who it is or what it is. It seems to be just numbers and sort of droppings. And it raises the issue of what is legitimately a drawing and what is not. Is any arrangement of marks on a paper a drawing? Or is there some kind of procedure which we have to make in order for it to be seriously considered as a drawing? That's something which I'm sure in art circles has been discussed from the days of Jackson Pollock and probably long before. If you see a bird dropping on a pavement which photographs elegantly, does it then become an artwork, etc., etc.? The question of conscious marking in drawing is also, of course, involved in technique, the question of technique. Here is a piece of intelligent marking that was done by somebody working for me a couple of months ago, where we had designed the building, we had won the competition, we then were moving on to the serious stuff of refining the project and placing a series of small windows on a complex curved surface. And this is, of course, a computer drawing, and in fact, the projection is one of those folding, rolling projections. You do not actually ever see the series of walls as they are indicated here, but the object of the exercise was to speculate on a number of different positionings of very small windows, some of which are used for dressing room windows and toilet windows and so on, in a piece of solid that had already been designed. And therefore the drawing becomes, the key part of the drawing becomes the comparative between one particular set of marks and its alternative. And these two are two out of about 15 or 18 that were done until Gavin and I sat in front of them and said, that's the one. As simply as that. Basing our choice purely, I think, upon sort of visual taste. All of them would work more or less the same. It becomes very analogous, I suppose, to the setting up of a stave in musical notation and then the dropping of the notes onto the stave. The stave can continue. It is the particularization of the positioning of the notes and that implication that matters. On the other hand, if we come to this kind of drawing, Marion Coletti drawing, which of course is produced entirely through manipulation of the computer, there is discrimination going on of a more complex kind. The elements are many. There is a hierarchy of the elements. There is even a kind of quasi-pictorialization going on. And since I don't myself understand the parameters of the program, I can only, again, rather look at such drawings and say, I like that one better than that one. I might, if you pin me to the wall, be able to sort of try and post-rationalize that and say, well, I think it's less repetitive, or I think it implies solidity more than the other, or I think it reminds me of some form of scattering, or the nature of the scatter, the nature of the diversity becomes a quantitative element. To what extent that is dependent upon the business of drawing, though, is there. Here I can be totally autobiographical with a 40-odd-year-old drawing, which I'm sure you've seen before. This particular drawing took a long time to do. That is not to say I sat there every day for a month, end to end. And it was not the first drawing of the project either. It was probably made at the time by which most of the hard thinking about the project had already happened. But it was a sort of culmination. It was in a tradition where a project which can be described by drawings and models needed a kind of summary statement. And certainly in the pre-computer days, a drawing such as this, which is an axonometric, which I presume you know, you may have heard of, an axonometric drawing was a mechanical in the sense you didn't have to deal with perspective. You just set it up at 45, 90, etc., and banged on. You took it off a plan. And it was a reliable way of producing a three-dimensional drawing. The reliability in this case depended upon it being kind of mostly evening and weekend work. I was gainfully employed by Taylor Woodrow during the day. And this was sitting on a drawing board in the corner of the room probably for something like 3 months between beginning and end. And if one had a sort of spare evening, you maybe drew that much. If you had a spare day, you maybe drew that much. If you had a spare weekend without anything else to do, you might do that much, and so on. And it got very dirty, and so bits of it had to be covered and cleaned up and so on, because it was on the board for so long. On the other hand, if something takes that long, there's a certain moment at which, in a funny way, you have to admit, you stop thinking. In the early stages, you're bracing yourself to see whether you can go through with it. You're also bracing yourself to see whether, because then and now, I still like to extemporize to a certain degree. I like to have enough sitting in my head to know that I can do the thing, but not so much as if I know exactly what's going to happen. I like to hold, let's say, something like about 35% of the thing open to extemporization, open to local variability. Otherwise, it's boring. If you know 99% what it's going to be, you become a kind of human machine. You just got to trog through with it. Those of you that get excited by letting the parametrics completely take over, and I should be talking a bit about that next week, perhaps have other ways of exciting yourselves. I'm not quite sure. I have a suspicion that we're able to do it. I'd get terribly bored by it, because I like the way in which art imitates life to the extent that you never quite know what's going to happen. You have a rough idea, you have a program, and it's the variables that may make life worth living. But in this drawing, about a third of the way through, I had solved most of the problems. I had decided the way in which I would draw capsules. It would have taken too long to set them up on stencils, so I had to trust myself that I could freehand them. On the other hand, I can't draw circles very well, so they were done with stencils and so on and so forth. By about a third of the way in, probably, and I can't quite remember, probably moving up from the bottom, I suspect, I've more or less got all the typologies rolling. So that by the time you've got, the middle gets to be an interesting bit, but by the time you get to the top third, you've more or less solved everything, and all you're doing is being a kind of trog. You're just sort of, got to get to the end of it, because if I don't get to the end of it, it won't be there. And you do get bored. You have to think of all sorts of cheer-up foibles. You have to sort of say, I'll do that bit by tonight, and then I'll have a double scotch, or, you know, I'll do that bit by tomorrow, and then I'll go to see a movie, or I'll do that bit, and then I'll watch television or something. You have to try and think of something that will be like a reward for, it's rather like going around the garden collecting leaves, you know, it becomes purely an achievement. I'm intrigued. Therefore, when we have somebody like Ali Rahim, who in his architecture, I see a lot of repetition, even though it purports to be particular. In fact, what he's doing here is simply turning the window. But I'm sure, being a clever chap, he knows exactly how to turn a window. He probably doesn't even have to look at the computer while it turns the window. And what intrigues me is what therefore goes through his mind. If you know that the window is going to turn like that, does the drawing of it, does the manifestation of it have any pleasure? Well, it might do, for the same reason that it was necessary for me to complete the Plug-in City drawing, which is, unless you have it, unless it happens to have been built, and I think in neither the case of this project nor certainly Plug-in City are they necessarily built. Therefore, the thing on paper might be the only thing you've got. It will enable you to get teaching jobs, pages in magazines, please your friends, even perhaps be sold in art galleries, a number of other byproducts of actually having something that you say, how's about that? This is what it is. So that it raises, and this happened in this building, in this school, many years ago, when I was teaching here, there was a weird conversation that I had with somebody called Dalibor Vasily, where he actually once said, the building doesn't matter, it's the drawing that matters. And I drew back shocked, even though at that time I had not built any buildings and I was known for making drawings. Nonetheless, it forced me to confront the issue as to whether the drawing is more important than the building, whether architecture can progress purely through drawn form. And although I was surviving, in a sense, by the making of drawings, such competitions as I had won and such projects that I'd had published and such jobs that I was given, mostly in academe, occasionally in galleries, were on the back of those drawings. But it meant that I admitted to myself that they were only part of the story, that they were a support mechanism for an uncompleted story, that without the existence of actual architecture, the drawings are, to my mind, a secondary tradition, a secondary pursuit. Now that's, in a way, a shocking thing to say. And I say that of both of hand-drawn drawings and drawn form in any other way, that unless it somewhere along the line, both culturally and operationally, has a relationship to the making of our environment, then it is, to me, too abstract. I would prefer to reverse the hypothesis and say that architecture and the environment can benefit enormously by the explorations that we make through drawings, whether they're hand-done drawings or not. That's okay, but to then say the drawing is sufficient unto itself as a pursuit, I still find worrisome. This is a man called Graham Williamson, who has a successful office called Block. They do lots of hairdressing shops and restaurants and so on. But as a drawer, his hand is able to produce a kind of strange world that implies a combination of natural fibers, growths, and weavings that, again, suggest an architecture that we haven't quite achieved as yet. We have difficulty with materials, we have difficulty with weaving, we have difficulty with things that grow because we never quite know how they might grow. And architecture is, after all, very largely about control. Nonetheless, the speculation is important, and it is possible to make such speculations by making drawings. It could have been said in Russia in the 1930s that such a thing as this, one of Chernikov's many contrivances, that no building exactly like it existed. By now, a lot of buildings, a lot of industrial plant exists that look somewhat similar, though perhaps not as pretty as this. There was, and there still is, I suppose, perhaps somebody here should do the test and go up to the library upstairs here and ask to see the original Chernikov 101 Fantasies book. When I was a fifth year student here, I and two friends would badger the librarian. She would watch us, she would stand behind us, would open this little cupboard with a key, open the book, and would watch us to see we didn't, basically see we didn't nick the book, or at least nick one of the pictures out of it. And I think in my fifth year, I and my two friends, we went three, she got really pissed off with us in the end because we kept going up saying, can we look at the Chernikov book? Open the door. But it was absolutely stunning. It was unlike anything that we had ever seen before, partly because it was exuberant, partly because it was compositionally wonderful, and partly because it was coloured. And I know that's a funny thing to say. That perhaps sort of slightly lowers the thing. And of course, not all of Chernikov's work was coloured. Here's some pretty stunning Chernikov drawing, which is perhaps even, you know, it's more sort of graphic than the previous one, which was not coloured. And there's an interesting relationship, I think. I'm no architectural historian, but there seems to be a weird relationship between the reputation and standing of Chernikov in relationship to the more venerated Russian constructivist architects, the Besnin brothers or such people who did make buildings. I don't think Chernikov ever built a building. He was considered a sort of artiste. And he came along slightly late, so that presumably all these other guys would grumble about him, that all he did was to sort of pick up on their ideas and stylize them. But by God, how wonderfully he did stylize them. And in another context, I would find it interesting to compare some of Chernikov's 101 Fantasies with a building that it took some years, I think another 10 years later, I actually came upon a building that looked like one of Chernikov's things, which was a building in Berlin called the Umlauf Tank, which is by an architect called Ludwig Leo. It is a pink pipe, some of you might know it, an enormous pink pipe which has green legs rising above it, and about four floors up into the sky is a blue building sitting on the green legs on the pink pipe. And when I saw this Ludwig Leo building, I thought, my God, Chernikov has come alive. It is possible. And then one thought, and I had the same sort of sequence of thinking that I had, of course, when we built the Kunsthaus in Graz, which is that certain things which could have existed as drawings and hitherto had existed as drawings, suddenly there it was. And then you think sideways, just as I thought apropos my own work, that if they could build the Kunsthaus, then they could have built a lot of the other things. And vis-a-vis the Umlauf Tank, I thought, God, if you can build this Umlauf Tank in Berlin, in, I think it was the end of the 1960s or early 70s, then, my God, you probably could have built, 83 of the 101 fantasies, which is a wonderful and frightening and inspiring thought. There's another artist whose work has been very influential amongst certain architect drawers, which is a man called Walter Pichler. Pichler is exactly my age and a very successful artist. He's the only artist I know of who has built buildings through the money that he made from making the drawings of the buildings that he was going to make. They are small buildings. They are attachments to a farm building in the Burgenland, I think, near to Vienna. And he made he's made a series of these drawings, and then he had some of these buildings house his own pieces of sculpture, so that he made the drawings, sold the drawings, got the money, did the buildings, did the sculpture, put the sculpture in the buildings. So it's a sort of complete loop, or at least that's the story I've been told. I'm sure it's a gross oversimplification. One of the exciting things about his work, and I realize this is not a brilliant slide, but is the way in which in some of his drawings he attacks the paper. He uses something called Schollerhammer Papier, which those of you who know Germany will know about. I occasionally bought it, and it drives your arm mad because it's so tough that to fight it with a pen or a pencil, it's so tough it almost fights back at you. It's like sort of walking on pavements in hard shoes for a very long time. Your arm aches after an afternoon working on it. But what he does is to scrunch up the paper. He attacks it and then drives the lines over the scrunched up paper, so there's a kind of fight, a physical fight going on between the artist and the actual drawing. And here you see some very Austrian spooky. There's a lot of Austrian death witch blood, spikes through animals combined with metal in his sculpture. It's a lot of that stuff which Tyroleans seem to be particular, and he is Tyrolean, particularly fond of, where there's a sort of battle going on between substances and death and spikes and food and paper and angst, a lot of angst. But he was a tremendous inspiration for many architects. This business of formalizing funny material, I can't be quite as Austrian and sort of grim as Walter Pichler. It's just not in my psychology. But in a funny English way, I many years ago did this drawing to a term which the late Rainer Banham used to use a lot, which was the term gunge. Gunge is a very Englishy sort of word, meaning sort of slurpy rubbish, sort of gunge. Sort of stuff that you get at the bottom of a drain if you clean a drain out is sort of gunge. And it was meant to be the combination of old railway sleepers, bits of cement slurry, and sort of moss and mud and cheap bits of wood that you found in a tip somewhere, etc., etc., all sort of slurped together. Quite what the pink thing is, and don't forget, it's a very old drawing. I can't quite remember what the pink, I mean the pink, immediately it's pink, and it's a bit sort of fashioned. You say, wait a minute, that you didn't find in a tip. That must be deliberate, it must be expensive, it must be special. And for some reason, it's so long ago I can't remember why, for some reason I felt it necessary to include amongst the range something that was not tacky, cheap, found at the bottom of the drain. Odd that. And also I'm puzzled by my own drawing because it's so long ago. I'm also puzzled by that sort of orange light bulb thing on the left there, which is either a light bulb or one of those sort of children's balloons that's waiting to be blown up. Quite an odd thing to find on the side of a piece of sort of old ribbed cardboard with cement over it, which is what the rest of it's supposed to be. So there was a subplot going on in my head, and I think that the irony is I've forgotten myself what the subplot was, because in things where it's been published, it says Gunge in large letters. And so I've remembered the Gunge bit of the story, but I can't remember what the other bit of the story was, which of course happens, that you can the great thing about, is that there's an apocryphal story, which is that in the early days of Zaha Hadid's office, she uses the very old Mac computers, the box-like ones. And apparently a lot of the drawings, there was some aspect of the program that enabled them to be inaccurate. And then the apocryphal story goes that the Mac company sort of cleaned up its act, and subsequently you can't break the rules. The mathematics of the thing don't allow you. And so her drawing mannerisms had to change because they had to be more correct. In parallel, I'm thinking of this business that one tends to be forced by friends and cultural situations, and sort of a feeling of responsibility, in having a succinct story to everything that you do. You say, this is about Gunge, these are the rules of Gunge, this is what it's about, end of story. Whereas you know that there was more to it than that. There's even physical evidence that there was more to it than that. But you can't remember what the bloody hell it was. In the same way that when you're having a conversation, you have subplots at the back of your head. I'm interested in subplots. I'm now going to have a little sequence of rather crappy drawings that I did about a year or so back for a project, which was also involved in the same thing, involved in Gunge. Here for a project in Madrid, which didn't seem to come to anything, we were asked to look at the business of a cheap system of making enclosing walls for building sites and bits of town that the municipality wanted to sort of shut off. So it's meant to be a sort of screening, semi-portable screening system. And somehow or other, I thought of Gunge again. And it's written on the top there. It says, wallowing in the aesthetic of pulverized recycled material. And I think as English designers, we enjoy the idea of wallowing. Say you've got people sitting there reading the newspaper and whatever else they're doing. And it's a very quick drawing. It was just a sort of scribbly thing, sort of like this. And because one wasn't drawing the recycled material very well, you put an arrow and says, recycled, but in case you didn't know what that scribble was, it's recycled material. So that's all right. Completely different from the sort of aesthetic, studied way in which the Gunge was dealt with much earlier, many years earlier. And so then one even got to the stage of doing a sort of almost freehand detail of how this stuff would work. Again, almost a Gunge, it's not in no way a working drawing, but it's a sort of indication of how one might build the thing. Further indications, and then somebody gets on the old Photoshop. And so the thing starts to look formalized. And as soon as the Photoshop takes over, and that was not me, the rest of it's me, somebody starts making it look a bit regular. And in a way, the gunginess goes. It starts looking like building materials do. But no, here we are, still scribbling away, saying, look, you can have a bloke looking through a hole, and you can have big posters, and in case you didn't know it was a big poster, it says big poster. You know, it's for the very daft. And then one has a sort of middle territory where I always introduce a dog if I want to sort of enjoy myself. on a drawing. And here we are, but it's already, even here, just by the addition of somebody going over it with a bit of grey Photoshop, it's already gone formal. I'm not saying this is the world's most formal drawing, don't get me wrong, but it's already beginning to be sort of plasticized in a curious way. Here's my friend Gavin Rowbottom doing a freehand drawing, and you see he's a fundamentally better freehand drawer than I. So there he can draw something with as wobbly a line as you ever like to think, but it has implicit structuring. It is constructible and has a different sort of authenticity. Even he can't draw anything which isn't sort of having a hint of authenticity. Well, in the end on this project, we made a model of it, and I think the model got back to the idea much more closely. We had somebody very carefully making a model, and she was very, very assiduous and followed instructions very, very carefully, and got closer to what the thing was really about. So what it suggests, because it was talking, that sometimes you would have real posters, you would have people poking their heads through floors, behind it would be buildings under construction, and it would be made of this funny combination of sort of hairy material and cement slurry. And you can do that with a model, and perhaps there's this issue that, you know, what is the point of a drawing? The drawing has no, in a case like this, has no particular value in itself. What is important is the idea. And if getting somebody to spend 3 or 4 days making a model gets the idea further, there's no preciousness to the making of drawing. But I continue with one of my own drawings, where one is trying again to summarize an unusual condition where both straightforward constructed objects, picky, fiddly constructed objects, eccentric constructed objects, slightly wayward bits of planting, and slightly more formalized bits of planting all come together. In other words, one's using the same technique to summarize a number of different pieces. And I guess this is where the technique by this time was one that I had been doing for a long time, and therefore I was able to control it. And I only put color where I needed to put color. And I only put any intricacy of line where I needed to put intricacy of line. Because the point is that it was a sort of visual catalog of a number of different unlikely bedfellows. On the other hand, here, an architect artist who I've only got to know in the last 2 years or so, who is Mark West, who teaches in Winnipeg, and is the man who is in charge of a very interesting experimental studio for the discovery of new techniques in concrete. And he's very known on the sort of international concrete inventing circuit. But he also does these sometimes quite naughty drawings, which are all done in pencil, where he has a technique where he uses the India rubber as a drawing tool. He sometimes covers parts of the drawing completely with graphite and then takes away rather like scraper board, for anybody who knows that technique, where you have a black patch and then you take away the black, revealing the white. In this case, he has that as one of his available techniques. They are, again, complexities. Why I put those in quick juxtaposition is that he's also involved in the same basic sort of trick, which is to put the unlike in juxtaposition with the unlike. So much of our thinking in architecture and so much of our drawing of architecture is to do with consistencies. That is, this is fascinating when one has intentional inconsistency. What was a feature, of course, of the École des Beaux-Arts, which had, after all, an immense drawing tradition? The École des Beaux-Arts, I'm referring to it, I suppose, in the period of the 19th century and early 20th century, predominantly the 19th century, Here, the architecture of the interior was every bit as important. This is a piece of the Paris Opera. The architecture of the interior was every bit as important as the architecture of the exterior. And therefore, the architect put all the effort onto the surfaces. And if you look hard, you can see the piece that's in section is left white, because it was a tradition of such designers that the technical chappies would come along and deal with that. As long as the plaster was in the right place, then you would, and the marble, that was the architecture. And then some boring character would come and fix bits of metal and wood and so on to keep it all up. I mean, I'm slightly exaggerating, but it was fundamentally a different approach to that of modernism, which said that it is the carcass, in a sense, which dictates the building, and the surfaces should be stripped. And so therefore the hierarchy of the sectional drawing reverses. The profile is just a profile. There is no particularization of the structure, but my God, the surface is developed. On the other hand, this, which is just as busy a drawing, is in another tradition of drawing which we should take into account, which is that of the sort of almost cartoon-like descriptive drawing, the drawing that puts everything there so you know what's going on. There's a one, when I had an offspring, when my son was young, we bought a lot of books by a man called Richard Scarry, which I should have actually included into this lecture, who did mostly animals doing sort of normal tasks of everyday humans. And they are very developed, these books. They're very particular. They have everything you can ever think, from how to make paper to sort of how to run a post office and how to live on an island, etc., 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 how to keep a bus service going, etc. All done with animals doing all these various things. But they are very precise. And here, this picture of a ship, in a way, is very precise. There's almost everything that you can think that would ever go on in a ship going on in there, including, you know, something sitting on a panel in front of a dial. The dial is in a frame, and behind the frame is a piece of further panel. And there's a box, and somebody sitting on the box, and somebody behind the person sitting on the box. And my God, if the guy drew more, he'd draw the padlock to the box. You know what I'm getting at? That it's sort of everything. Everything is seen. And it raises the issue of discrimination. Do we clarify by giving more information, or do we clarify by giving less information? And I think that applies to every kind of drawing, mechanical, computational, or other, because it is really a central issue about the relationship between drawing and the actual. It would have been impossible for us to build the building in Graz without the use of the computer. Well, it would have been possible, perhaps, if you had an endless supply of money and about 50 years in which to do it. Then perhaps it would have been possible by ancient methods. But with the computer, it was possible to do it in just over 2 years with not more than 30 people at the design end ever, and something like about 700 drawings, most of which were produced semi-automatically. And that therefore the precise positioning of these elements of the building was very easily possible. The clarification on the drawing is then just purely a code, as I'm sure you're all well versed in, that the code has decided to discriminate between two sets of information, one which will then be shown in varieties of pink, one which will be shown in varieties of green. On the other hand, a drawing which I just noticed as I was having a quick drink up in the bar in a poster, this drawing that I made many years ago concerned with orifices. I did not know that I would some years later, make a building that had orifices. What's interesting to compare the two is, of course, the amount of pain that doing this drawing caused and the amount of time that it took. It probably took much longer to produce this drawing than that drawing. Albeit that the green drawing has simpler orifices. Therefore, the implications of the old drawing are more curious. It is saying that there is the need to invent a series of orifices. They do not all have to be the same, but there is no hard dividing line between the surface of the transparent or translucent part and degrees of solidity. Not only degrees of solidity, even degrees of questionable solidity, degrees of granularness, that in a sense what is happening in this sort of the suppurated part of the drawing, bottom, in the, particularly in the bottom orifice, is that the transparent, translucent part is suppurating, is creating a sort of subcellular system which in itself then disintegrates into rivulets. Whereas the stuff in Graz is pretty simple. There's the hole, the light comes through the hole, the tube lands, and it rolls round to the bottom. It's a simpler proposition. God help us if we had tried to build this in Graz. I think they really would have thrown up. And so in that connection, one is fascinated by, for example, people like Marcus Novak, who I think also enjoys the equivalent of my earlier suppuration in a digitally produced drawing. He's able to feed into it moments of ambiguity or subdivision that is inconsistent subdivision. This is the point I'm making. So to backtrack to somebody like Neil Denari, who is able to present a series of comparable pieces as a flat arrangement with such power, I probably not for your generation, but for a sort of generation before you, or generation and a half before you. Neil Denari was probably one of the most inspiring architects around. He hadn't built anything at that time, but he was much beloved by a generation of architects who wanted to move beyond the modernist language but didn't want to be postmodern, who wanted to involve mechanistics but wanted to control those mechanistic elements within broadly within the canon of placeable pieces of architecture. One still likes to draw things quickly. One likes to do a series of repeats and comparatives, whilst in the end knowing that at a certain moment these will have to be formalized and one will have to be more pernickety. And in fact, these two drawings are related as being part of the same project, but at a certain moment the formalized, this drawing actually is a hand drawing made on top of a computer drawing in order to improve the computer drawing. When I talk about the work of another friend of mine, Kenny Tsui, I'm fascinated by the ability of the computer to allow for independent and Baroque thinking. And it gives me much amusement to show you this, because I always feel that Kenny, who comes from the institution at the other end of Bloomsbury, is allowed to be more Baroque than I think most of you. And that intrigues me to then sort of slightly wind you up and say, hey, come on, guys, why is it that a lot of stuff here is so boring and repetitive and similar, when I know it can be proved that the same techniques can produce stuff that isn't boring and similar. I'm not talking entirely about drawing here, of course. There were moments in the past, and we go back to the 60s again, when something complex could not be beautifully drawn. But the author was French, probably made that also an issue, because the French in general don't have, since the École des Beaux-Arts period, don't have a lot of stamina for drawing. And therefore, they're very, very good at schematic drawings. And Stinko's Travelling Hall, which is, after all, from the Utopie group, who were parallel group to Archigram, is a wonderful and clever project. It anticipates a lot of things that came later. And again, it's rather like the Gunge drawings. It can be argued that it doesn't actually need to have better drawings, that these sketches are quite enough. There is the way of using drawing to romanticize and to dramatize, and surely there is the tradition of the work of Hugh Ferris. Hugh Ferris was an artist, architect, I think mostly operating in the 30s, 40s, and I think he lasted through to the 50s. I'm not quite sure what happened to him. But he did a lot of projects such as this, which some were done as sort of hypothetical schemes. Most of them were commissioned by big-time architects. So they'd bring Hugh Ferris in to make it look wonderful and dramatic and heroic, and which he was able to do. Sometimes they're a bit more pragmatic, and despite the wonderful Hugh Ferris drawing, you actually, if you take away the romanticism, you say, hey, wait a minute, wouldn't that be some bloody great Hulk, actually? Whereas there is also the use of, I deliberately put this one next to the Hugh Ferris because it's very, very different in mood. I was first turned on to modernist architecture by finding a book in the Bournemouth Public Library that showed a restaurant made in 1930 in Stockholm by the architect Gunnar Asplund. It was part of a thing called the Stockholm International the Stockholm Exhibition of 1930. I'm old, but I'm not that old. It was. One never saw it. One's only ever seen it in the form of black and white photographs and these coloured drawings. But what's interesting is that what actually was a piece of very, very progressive architecture, probably borrowing a lot from the Russians, but not entirely. The drawing is not actually by Asplund, it's by some other bloke, name I've forgotten. But they brought in this Swedish artist to make it palatable for the general public. This is a sweetie version. Because if you actually get closer to the built architecture, you start looking at it, it was quite powerful stuff. It probably stuck in the throat of a lot of the sort of bourgeois Swedish public of the time. But here is a nice drawing with nice colours and people being jolly and very Swedish and light, like Swedish art, rather like that. So that it could be absorbed into the sort of bourgeois life, and it looks like a fair, and it's not going to last, and it's nice, and it's sweet, and it's light, and it's colours, bright colours. So, in a sense, one part of me is amused, and the other half of me is irritated, because in a sense, what impressed me about the architecture is that it was so inventive and special and different. But what the drawing is trying to say, don't worry, chaps, it's going to be nice, it's all right, it's a beautiful place, and nice flute music to go with it. Funny how things go. I think I've tested a few people that I know. Very few people now know about this drawing, unless you're of a certain generation. I can see some people near the front here probably do remember it. It was done by somebody called Peter Wilson, who is an architect now living in Munster, and doing some rather good buildings. But he was a very, very, very influential AA teacher at the time when he made this drawing, which is called the Fountain House. And it was a drawing that so many people envied because it was so beautiful of its kind and inimitable. There were a lot of people around the AA at the time. We're talking about the sort of late 70s, I suppose, or mid 70s even. There were people around who took basically these little rationalist elements, but couldn't make them as evocative as Peter could make them. He just could draw them so extraordinarily with the steam coming out and this sort of... It probably looks incredibly dated. Well, probably most of what I'm showing looks incredibly dated. But you have to take my word for it that this drawing had immense impact throughout the whole school. Everybody wanted to do stuff like this. And just most of them didn't have the technique, didn't have the eye to just know just how blue to make it, just how pink to make it, how to get that steam. Drawing water and drawing steam are two of the hardest things to do. And even, you have to be very tricky you have to virtually steal things in Photoshop to be able to do it. But to draw it is a kill. And one comes inevitably to a key figure. One, of course, could give a complete lecture on the subject of Lebius Woods. I'm summarizing it in three drawings only. One is Lebius Woods, the hero. Lebius Woods came in onto the commercial scene in New York. He, for some years, made his money by doing perspectives for other architects, somewhat, when I say in the manner of Hugh Ferris, I mean commercially in the manner of Hugh Ferris, but actually technique-wise with much more variety. And on the side did his own projects for kind of future cities and so on. And what Lebius is able to do is to give it that near realism. You know that this is something that doesn't exist, but only just. You look at a drawing like that, you think, maybe it does exist. If I said to you, actually, it's somewhere, east of Potsdam and to the south of Zagreb or something, and it's done by Otto Schnunk, that one or two of you might believe me. I might even believe it myself. Because the concrete looks possible. The bent pipe looks possible. There are even hints that the pipe isn't perfect. There are even hints that the surface of the metal isn't perfect, just like stuff is really out there. Whereas Chernikov's fantasies, the blue was blue and the yellow was yellow. It was a distanced manifestation. Here, the distancing is less, and in a sense, it becomes, in many ways, the more powerful because there is the possibility that it might be actual, or if it is not actual, it can be actual. When we're talking about propositional architecture, that gets to very, 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 very dangerous moment where it can be actual because it suits the Philistines if all this stuff is rubbish and you can't build it. As soon as you get to the points where you can build it, that was the excitement of Ludwig Leer's Umlauf tank. It was the excitement for me of Graz and so on. To say, hey, fuck you, you can do it. There it is. Suddenly, what about all these other drawings? So Lebius Wood's stuff can be built, albeit that then at a later date where he starts to involve in action and attack. And a very interesting trick that he plays with this particular drawing, where it goes from color to black and white, and then from color to cross-section. In other words, where he's almost taking a kind of filmic approach to the manifestation. Just when you think that something might be happening, he breaks and abstracts it. A man fantastically in control of his medium. And here, a Lebius Woods drawing, which is particularly significant. There's a whole series of lead-up drawings to this drawing, except that it's not a drawing, it's actual. It was actually an assembly in a room in the Angerwander Museum in Vienna, a room of about the size of this room, filled with these metal rods. But extraordinary, for somebody who built up a tremendous reputation for drawing and had done a series of preliminary drawings to this, you open a door and you are in a Lebius Woods drawing. And that was about 8 years ago. It was really scary. It was amazing because it broke the boundary, but in a kind of very controlled way. It says, I will use the language that I have established, that all my public knows about. And you open the door, you expect to see more drawings, but it's real, and suddenly you're inside it. The drawing almost as an end in itself. And of course, with the computer, it's possible to get into that isn't territory of where do you draw the line between the drawing and the three-dimensional manifestation. There is no, suddenly the significance of surface, meaningful surface, becomes a very ambiguous one. This is a Colton McDonald contraption. I don't actually know whether it has three-dimensional form or not. I think it does, but knowing them, it could just be a flat manifestation, very cleverly leading me to believe that it's three-dimensional. I just found this one in sort of by accident yesterday, looking through some stuff, which is also Colleton MacDonald. It's them. I think it's actually out of Neil Spiller's new book. It's them horsing around collecting constituent pieces. I thought it was rather interesting, because generally one sees theirs and similar work in a sort of formal consistency. And here it is pre-consistent. It's still a series of almost pieces of source material hanging around, almost like paint sitting on a palette ready to be made into the painting. And the pieces of paint haven't yet quite been combined. And I find that conceptually very, very interesting, coming from where they're coming from, which is the notion of pre-assemblage, of dealing with the inconsistent, the unlike next to the unlike. As you've probably gathered by now, I'm fascinated by compositions which involve the unlike next to the unlike. And as usual, somebody who I'm sure most of you are familiar with, which is Hernán Díaz Alonso, who I think also has a taste for the unlike with the unlike, although in this particular instance there is a sort of hierarchy between the apparently translucent parts and the apparently solid parts. In another of his contrivances, we're also taken straight out of the Neil Spiller book, I think, already the story has spread that his, by drawing attention to the different coloration, by drawing attention to different families of form, he's in a sense moving round to the idea, or the tradition, shall I say, of complex composition. I don't mean just complex formal composition, but derivations from different families which have to somehow coexist. Again, it's my sort of core theme, in a sense. Just to backtrack, of course, having got to this moment, we're showing Colmack and Alonso. We have to remember that Mr. Finsterlin, many years before, would have loved to have had a computer, I'm sure. Would have probably been rather good at it. He would have composed brilliantly. Unfortunately, he didn't have a computer. He had a pen and some sort of coloring materials, and he was suggesting a very similar kind of architecture. He just didn't have the means. It will be interesting in historical terms to discuss where a certain idea originates and to what extent the technique enabled it to be more developed or not. We all say, yes, of course, since the computer can develop it more. But if Finsterlin was as imaginative as this, working with bloody pen and a bit of, you know, colored crayon or whatever, what the hell might he have done? I just throw that in. If one is preoccupied by one condition in one drawing, and here in a project called Super Houston, I'm preoccupied by the condition of a city that sits under the trees. I borrowed from part of the real Houston, which does sit under trees, and then superimposed my own computer-controlled traffic and large 10-mile tent onto it. In this drawing, I'm concentrating really upon the trees and the basics of the system. In a detailed drawing, I still have the trees drawn, but just as a diagrammatic tree, because I'm then wanting to draw attention to a very particular architectural element within the system. And so they are the only bits that are colored. The rest is deliberately kept black and white, kept, quote unquote, as a diagram. It's where one says, once it is black and white, it can be considered diagram. Therefore, please, can we concentrate upon the blue and orange elements, because they are what I'm talking about at this moment. Very simple discrimination. Again, though here in a computer-produced drawing, it's also it's a town plan that was a piece of town that we hoped to build. We didn't get to build it, but it was a serious job. Again, one is using color to draw attention to certain elements, though in this case they are all drawn by artificial means. But the business of which is where diagram enters the conversation about drawing. The same publishers who made my book on drawing are shortly to be doing a book on diagrams, not by me, by that guy who teaches at the Royal College, his name I forget. That would be interesting. I showed this drawing last week in talking about Oslo. I want to remind you that here one's experiment using a technique for the elevation part that I had done many times, but experimenting with the idea of the discussable cartoon. And in a way, as I look back on it now, sort of 3 years or so later, in a way, I'm more interested in the discussable cartoon than the particular manifestation above it. In a project which we are about to build, which is a theatre in Verbania by Lake Maggiore, the drawing, it was necessary at a certain moment to use that same sort of technique as in the ship drawing, where you take the end off the thing and you say, let's come inside and show you all the bits. It's where the computer drawing uses the techniques of the old simplified cutout. There's nothing better than a cutout to explain, and this was a drawing done largely for lay people rather than for other architects, where one says, well, we will show you how the theatre works, we will show you how the plan of the old building works, we will show you, and we will cut away the piece that we particularly want to talk about. It's a very simple procedure. Now, if this works, no, it doesn't want to work again. The thing is that the drawing does animate, but it doesn't seem to want to. Which would have been the ultimate trick to say, well, now just when you're getting used to that idea, by the way, it whizzes round so that you can have a drawing that can exist on a number of levels. And with a little bit of very simple programming, which hasn't been done yet, you could say, here's a complete building with the lid on. Here's the building with the lid coming off. And then here's the building as we move through it. In other words, again, where is the dividing line between the drawing per se and any other way of describing an object? The use of bright color, of ridiculous color, is of course something, it's an old trick. I borrowed this trick actually from my own teacher, who was Peter Smithson. There was a wonderful, again, used to exist in the slide library, a project that Peter Smithson had done when he was a postgraduate student at the Royal Academy, which was a competition project, where the sky was red. The rest of the drawing was perfectly legitimate black and white drawing, but the sky was red. And there was something that really remained in my memory about this red sky drawing, which I appropriated here in this particular project. If you take away the red sky, the color coding would be still a mixture of symbolic coding, symbolic colours and real colours. You know, sort of pale blue for windows is sort of fairly normal. Green screens, yes, that's all right. A bit of a wall painted red, that's all right. But my God, and some pink hotel bedrooms, that's all right. But as soon as you put the red sky behind it, suddenly those colours become deliberately more ordinary. You reduce their importance as coloration. You just have them as a bit of coding because the whole thing is held by the red. Marcos Cruz's drawings of the absurd use combinations of hand drawing and Photoshop and has a sort of subplot within his head, which is that the more humanistic elements will be photographic, and then when it becomes less humanoid, it becomes drawn, which is another tradition where you say we will choose the appropriate degree of reality depending on what we want to viciously say about the components. Will Alsop, on the other hand, makes the whole thing a complete cartoon. And you only have to, you sort of almost have a double take looking at it. You assume it's a nice, jolly, hairy picture. It could very well sit in one of the Frieze art fairs, and you might walk past it, you might not walk past it. And then you say, hey, hold it. Not only is the guy an architect, but it's a sort of building in the middle. Not a very interesting building, not very beautifully drawn, but it is a building. And it's a sort of wonderful, disarming decoy thing, that if you're looking at something that's full of leopard spots and odd, weird shapes existing in a fog with a sort of sunny splurge in the corner, do you want to notice that it is a building or not? Very interesting question. If you sort of decoy the thing enough, does this building cease to be a building? On the other hand, here, in the work of Enrique Miralles, who did not go out of his way to pretend that he was a brilliant drawer, he in fact was a brilliant drawer, but he was a brilliant composer of buildings, more important. You can't prevent wonderment. I don't know how much the drawing projects on the screen, but it's done in absolutely straightforward sort of working drawing mannerism. It's no special techniques at all. It's single thickness of line apart from the pre-existent building, single thickness of line, dimensions all over it, lots of stuff going on. And you just look at it and you say, that is one hell of a designer. That is an extraordinary, extraordinary, extraordinary building. But it's also got information about, you know, window jams and thicknesses of step and also all the normal mumbo jumbo that appears on a normal working drawing. And that is a salutary thought, isn't it? That after all this discussion about technique and discrimination and symbolism and the ethics of drawing and so on and so forth, that if the design is a wonderful, wonderful design, the drawing can be as pragmatic as you like. I mean, absolutely bog standard drawing. The thing is wonderful. Sometimes you can do a silly drawing. I was asked the other day to do the cover of a magazine, and I did this in 2 hours. The drawing bit took about half an hour. The colouring took about an hour and a half, and I got paid money. So I also do a bit of drawing whoring on the side. I've shown quite a lot of things that aren't in the book this morning, but if you didn't know about the book, I was going to say you can buy it downstairs in the Triangle book group. Oh, sorry, it's not there, but...